Hi, this is Kent Crow with Things Your Mother Didn't Tell You. My new boss leaned back in her chair, cocked an eyebrow, and squinted. What should I bill your time at, she asked. I had a small lump in my throat. I hadn't thought about what I was worth as a new lawyer. I was thinking about $125 an hour, came my reply. She shook her head. Nah, maybe $90, not $125. I just got my first lesson in what my future clients would pay for a baby lawyer and how lawyers set their rates. Recently, I've found myself asking that old question about what a lawyer's time is worth. It's taken 25 years to get around to it, but now I've formed some strong opinions and a better idea of what a client should know and what they should ask before they agree to pay more than a particular lawyer is worth. But how can you know what a lawyer is worth any more than you can know what your plumber should charge? Let's face it, lawyers charge a lot of money for a lot of reasons. When a lawyer sets his fee, he's charging you for what it costs to run his office, pay his staff, the electric bill, and the phone. A lawyer will also tell you he charges for his experience, the complexity of the case you have, and whether it will require him to go to trial. Good trial lawyers charge a lot of money, but so do bad ones. A lawyer should be willing to take the time to discuss your case. If he won't spend time with you or tries to hurry you out of his office, find another lawyer. If it's a routine matter, he should tell you that. If it's a difficult case, he should know that too. When you pay him to do a routine matter, he usually gives the case to his staff, who do much of the paperwork. He signs the papers and makes the phone calls. He may charge you by the hour, or he may charge you a flat fee. He may be efficient, charming, and hardworking. He may return your phone calls and keep you informed, or he may take your money and leave you in the dark. He may know how to try a case, or he may have never stood before a jury or argued a case to a judge. What's that worth, and how can you know? The answer isn't simple, but neither is buying a car, hiring a plumber, or an electrician. In every case, you should ask some questions. Just because someone is a lawyer doesn't mean they have the experience you need. If you don't know the lawyer, ask how long they've been practicing. Ask if they've handled a case like yours, and if they have, how many. Don't be afraid to ask them for references, and always ask how they're going to charge you. And always get a contract. It's called an attorney-client agreement. When you consult with a lawyer, what you tell him is always considered confidential. But you don't have a lawyer until you pay him and have a contract. And you should know that you can try to negotiate a better price. When you do that, you may find that a lawyer is willing to give you different prices depending on how your case is resolved. Finally, be a wise consumer. Shop around. Get a second opinion about your case or a second quote. You could save yourself hundreds of dollars. Thanks for tuning in. This is Kent Crow with Things Your Mother Didn't Tell You. Hi, this is Dan Croats with all the news from Berryville. A consolation of growing older, at least for men, is the expanding pool of attractive and interesting women. Adolescent boys are rarely capable of entertaining lascivious, let alone even casual, thought about women over the age of 25. Women over 30 never even cross their consciousness, no matter what Hollywood fictions like The Summer of 42 might suggest. Ben Franklin, that wisest of Americans, tersely summarized what boys don't know and most smart men do. In the night, all cats are gray. I suppose such musings, Father Franklin's and mine, show an evolving lack of modern sensibility. But a pretty woman in new shoes shines like a good deed in a grumpy world, and hearts and minds will go where they will go. One is allowed to walk in the garden and enjoy the garden without picking the daisies. I am especially fond of produce markets, a place where women, as the poet Byron wrote, are not old nor young nor at the years which certain women call a certain age, which yet the most uncertain age appears. These women are intent on thumping melons
inhaling the ambergris of new potatoes and measuring the worthiness of dug and bundled carrots. It is a pleasure, not in the least guilty, to observe the sapience and know-how of these experienced, discerning, and comely buyers of roughage. You might be thinking, oh damn, there's an old perv standing over by the lettuce. Go ahead. You will only remind me of Mother Gonzaga, a sister of Notre Dame who dedicated her entire life to warning me against occasions of sin. There are some people, like Mother Gun, who generate within themselves an asperity that nothing can sweeten. Be that way if you want to. Meanwhile, the Eureka Springs Farmers Market is open Tuesday and Thursday mornings at Pine Mountain Village. The Holiday Island Farmers Market is open on Friday mornings near the entrance gate to the island. And the Berryville Farmers Market is open Saturday mornings in the parking lot next to the community center. I encourage you to go to our farmers markets. You will find women of a certain age, occasions of sin, and pretty good roughage. Thanks for tuning in. Until next time, this is Dan Croats with all the news from Berryville.
Hi, everyone. This is Jim Young, your host for Be Here Now, BEHEARNOW, the weekly program that is established to help us all look in our heart of hearts to find the truth by which to live, to fulfill our purpose day by day. Namaste. I honor your divinity in all its forms. We're going to continue with a little excerpt from the book called The Course of Love by Marie, M-A-R-I, Ferron, F-E-R-R-O-N. This particular excerpt comes from a chapter called The New You. This covenant is the fulfillment of the agreement between you and your God. The agreement is for you to be the new. As you are new, then so is your God, for you are one, if not the same. As you are new, so too is the world, for you are one, if not the same. If you are new, so are your brothers and sisters, for they too are one, if not the same. While not the same, you also are not different. The differences you saw during the time of learning, the differences you made you feel as if each being stood separate and alone, you are now called to see no more. In unity, you are whole and inseparable, one living organism now raised above the level of the organism as you become aware of unity of form. It is time now for this idea to be accepted, for if it is not, you will remain in the prison you have created. The prison is an excellent example of the system you created with your faulty perception. As with all systems, it reflects an inward state and shows you what becomes of all those who see now what it means to be neither different nor the same, but to be one. For the moment, disregard any idea you may have of there being those who deserve the prison system you have developed and any arguments you would cite about the heinous crimes of some. Think instead of prison simply becoming a way of life for those who are incarcerated there. Each of you has had an imprisoned personal self. Each of you who have entered the cosmic consciousness has had the cell door and the prison gate thrown open and a new world offered. If you do not accept this opportunity, you may remain incarcerated in a system that tells you when you will awaken, how you will spend your day, and when you will retire. You remain at the mercy of those who are incarcerated along with you. You remain at the mercy of those who would have power over you, and you remain subject to the laws of man. I tell you truthfully that until you are living as who you are and are doing what you love, you are in prison. This prison is much of your own making, as are the crucial actual prison systems that develop when shape and form was given to what you fear and what you believe will protect you. Just as an actual prisoner, when released from prison, must adjust to life in which his or her actions are no longer restricted artificially, you must adjust to your new freedom. Your life has been artificially restricted by the prison you have created of it. The actual prison system merely mirrors this restriction on a grand scale for all to see and look upon with dread. For most, the prison system is a very successful deterrent. The thought of time in prison fills the mind with fear. And yet those who are imprisoned often become so acclimated to prison life that life on the outside is no longer seen as desirable. How can this be? A life of artificial structure is all any of you have known. An internally structured life will quickly replace the life of the inmate if you will but let it do so. Even those who actually are incarcerated in the prison system you have made are free to follow an internally structured life to a greater extent than many of those who call themselves free. But we are left with a divine design. All we are left with is what is given, a divine universe, a divine existence. That divine universe, our divine existence, is now recreating the patterns that serve the time of learning. What was learned in the instant in which you came to know yourself is all that learning was for. Let us not dwell any longer on why this has taken so long or on the suffering that occurred during the time of learning. This would be like dwelling on an inmate's life as an inmate once has been freed. Let us simply create a new structure around the new pattern of acceptance, a structure that will provide you with the home on earth you have so long sought and use your faculty systems to but attempt to replicate. Dear brothers and sisters, I hear your protests and the reasons that you feel must prevent you from acceptance I call you to. Yet as you fully accept that your right to your inheritance, your right to be who you are, and your commitment to the covenant of the new are one and the same, these reasons will disappear. All the different reasons you would cite become what they are, one reason, the same reason, and you will see that what is one is neither the same nor different. You will see that there is one answer, an answer different for everyone and yet the same for everyone. The answer is acceptance of yourself. The answer is acceptance of the new you. And so we have another chapter on the new you, a part of A Course of Love, a course that helps you look at life from your heart of hearts instead of from the mental configurations that have warped our view of life over our lifetimes. And so I hope you enjoyed this today. Visit my website, www.creationspirit.net. Also, drop me a note if you wish about this or any of the other sessions that we are here together to enjoy week to week. Do that at BeHereNow, BeHearNow77, at gmail.com. Know this about us. I love you. Namaste.